pass it over, page you pass it over.
Yep.
Tell them we're ready, all right? Thank you. Red words here?
Yeah.
Pass, how are you today?
Well, good morning, everyone. Give yourselves a hand for being here today.
So excited to have a great discussion here in this house, and we want to give honor to the man of God of this house. Thank him for allowing us to use this space. Obviously, we are for the people, by the people, and so is he. Give it up for Pastor Dozier. And we're going to have an interesting panel discussion, but before we get started, my name is Suzette Speaks. Hey, boo. How are you? My intern at where I work.
How are you? Good to see you.
So we're so excited. This is going to be very informal. Obviously, we have a lot of questions that we'd like to ask of our elected or maybe elected officials. So we want to make sure you get your voices heard. The protocol we'll use is I think we're going to have cards, note cards that we'll be passing around. Thank you, Wade. So if you want to write your question on a note card, as soon as you want one, please wave and we'll get one to you to make sure we get this discussion started. Pastor, would you open us up with prayer?
Well, it is so good to have you all here. You know, first of all, I want to thank God for Kevin Doro and his staff, who truly recognizes that Black Lives Matter, especially the thousands of young Black men and women who have lost their lives recently to other blacks. I thank them. Praise God. And everyone else, please pray. Our Heavenly Father, which art in heaven, Father God, we invoke your presence today. Father God, we pray that you would come into our midst. And Father God, we pray that you would cause our time together to be fruitful, informative, and enjoyable. And Father God, we pray that you would bless the sponsors and the coordinators and the speakers of this great event. And Father God, we pray that you would bless the dignitaries and the visitors and the friends. And Father God, we pray that you would bless all of those parents out there. We pray that you would dry the eyes of the bereaved families of the young Black men and women who have lost their lives unjustly to law enforcement officers. And at the same time, dear God, we pray that you would dry the eyes and give peace, please, Father, to the bereaving families of the law enforcement officers who have lost their lives in the line of duty. And Father God, we pray that you would also dry the eyes and give peace to the bereaving families of the thousands of young Black men and women who've lost their lives to other Blacks. And Father, we pray today that you would just touch our nation. We pray for all of the situations that are going on around the world. We pray for peace, dear God. And Father God, we pray that you would just touch all of our leaders. Please, Father, from the president on that ground, we pray, dear Father God, that you would give them direction. Give them your wisdom, your knowledge, and your understanding so that as they seek to govern this nation, they will be so according to the precious words of God. And Father, again, we thank you. And we ask all these things in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen.
Thank you very much, Pastor Dozier. Before we get started, I don't know about you, but I've been watching all, have you been watching all the crazy news happening?
Yes.
Hasn't like the last 2 weeks been like the craziest? With all the deaths we've experienced, both the Dallas, New Orleans, Minnesota. There was a coup apparently last night in Turkey. Did you see this? OMG. Like, the world is really, really upside down at the moment. So I just want to take a moment of silence. Let's just clear our minds. Thinking about and paying homage to those who've lost their lives, people who are in countries where there is just instability. Aren't you thankful you're in America? For all the problems we have, aren't you thankful you're in America? My goodness, it's been a crazy week. So we're just going to take a 10-second moment of silence to remember all the people that are dealing with other issues and who have passed on. Thank you. And this time we have a little bit of a program before we start our panel discussion. And we're going to start with a spoken word piece. As she comes, I'll just introduce myself again. My name is Suzanne Speaks. I'm an attorney and a journalist. I'm president of the South Florida Black Journalists Association. I host shows for Trinity Broadcast Network. If you watch TVN, any TVN watchers, you'll find me on their local public access show called Joy in Our Town, where I interview people with nonprofits and just talk about the good work they're doing in the South Florida community. I also host a daily newscast for Caribbean National Weekly. I don't know if you've seen that paper sometimes in your patty shop. But we do a daily broadcast every day talking about really Florida, South Florida, and the Caribbean, what's happening around our region. And I think you'll enjoy that. You can always sign up for our e-newsletter each and every day. And it's like maybe 2 minutes, 3 minutes. It won't take too long, and you'll get that email every morning. I'm also an attorney. I own my own law firm called Fort Lauderdale Law Group. I practice real estate law. So if you're a realtor, you're looking to buy yourself, see me. Gotta get that shameless plug in. All right, well, thank you for being here again. It's early, it's a Saturday morning. You could be anywhere, but you chose to be here because you felt this discussion was important. So let's go ahead and begin our program. I'd like to invite up our spoken word poet, Miss Redwoods. But when it's not 9 to 5 for Representative Jones, I'm a spoken word artist. I go by the name of Red Words, like me on Facebook. Today I'm going to share with you a poem that actually King, I don't know where he went, but I saw him earlier. King Kevin actually asked me to perform this piece after performing it at a gospel jam that I saw him at last month. And I'm actually a freestyle spoken word artist, and I also do write. So this morning, what I'm going to do for you is a little mixture of both. It's really a poem that speaks to truth in believing in yourself, having courage to move forward, as well as, instilling greatness in others. So without further ado, this poem is called, or entitled, If You Believe.
Instilled in me greatness. For too long seconds that I'm alive, nor the minutes in the day or the hours, nor the months in the year. Never, never did I believe in myself to ever be great. But yet here I stand, and on my 2 feet, I try my best to know that I have something within me that I can share with the world, and God gave it to me. But in my veins, I just feel this raging pain. This pain that's inside, I'm dying inside. Why must we all die with our dreams? You have to actually believe and make them reality. Because if you don't, honey, it won't come true. And don't you know that if your dreams don't come true, no one will do them for you. You see, you are the new resolution. You are part of the solution. You will lead the new day revolution. You have a song that beats in your heart. That song called life. When I was in the depths of despair, didn't know I was going anywhere. I didn't know that I was great. But somebody told me, hold on to him, for he will always be there. And every time I let go,
believe it and execute the plan. Welcome, Ms. Moss. Suzanne, just want you to know that I feel my purpose here today is to address the community and let you know who I am. I want to say thank you very much and welcome. Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, candidates, community leaders, boys and girls, and again, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Connie Moss. I am the president of Motivational Movements Network here in Broward County. I am currently the campaign manager for Ms. Mae Smith, who is running for the City of Lauderdale Commission Seat 3. I want to tell you, ladies and gentlemen, that I am proof that when you pray, and you pray earnestly, and you ask, you will receive. I ask for a mentor. I ask for education. I ask to be led in the right direction. Ladies and gentlemen, a lot of times all you have to do is ask. What I strive to do with Motivational Movements Network, my best friend and I, we wanted to bottle motivation and encouragement. Oh, if we could just do that. If we could just take a sip of motivation and encouragement at the times that we need it, wouldn't that be great? At the times when we felt despair and low and scared, we could just pick up a bottle and drink from it. And we would be able to stand tall, speak our peace, do what we have to do, and fulfill our purpose. Oh, wouldn't it be great if we could just take a sip of motivation and encouragement? Well, that's what I decided that I was going to do. As impossible as it sounds, I said, I want to put motivation and encouragement in a bottle. And sometimes they call a bottle a vessel. And I decided I was going to be that. I'm going to be a vessel. I'm going to be a vessel of motivation and encouragement. And if you need that, you can come take a sip of me. That's what I decided to do. So therefore, as I am encouraging our women of the community, I was formerly in business as the Black Motivated Women's Network. Then I decided I can be as motivated and as strong and as positive as I want to be. Hey, I'm a black woman. That's what I'm going to do. But who am I really? I am a woman who needs to look up to a man. A man needs to be the leader of the community. A man needs to go ahead and set the tone for the home, for the life, for the purpose of his family. So great job, women. I continue to encourage you on a daily basis. But let's not forget or ever turn our backs on our men in our community. So as I decided, and I said, well, hey, women, we're going to get together now and we're going to encourage the men of our community. We can no longer call it the Black Motivated Women's Network. I have to pray on this now. What am I going to do? I'm trying to encourage my whole community because, as they say, it takes a village. I'm going to change the name. I'm going to start encouraging our men, and I'm going to get a leader of our men because I don't want them to see me encouraging them. I need to seek out a leader of men. So I met a Poets and Authors networking event about 3 years ago, and I met a dynamic gentleman, just to impress as always, saying hello, shaking hands. You would think he was a politician, but he's not. He's just a fantastic community activist. I met this young man and I readily invited him to our first ever men's meeting held by the Black Motivated Women's Network at the time. But it was in the process of change. Don't be scared of the process of change, ladies and gentlemen. As we sit here and stand here and live here in the United States of America, do not be scared of a process of change. Because through change, it takes progress. And progress will create a different culture. People have to open their minds and their hearts. You cannot be afraid of change. Let us not be captured in a spirit of fear. Because lest we forget, hate hates everybody. Hate So it is your duty, ladies and gentlemen, of all races, of all nationalities, of all religious backgrounds, to say, hey, I'm going to make a stand against hate and religious prosecution. I'm going to make a stand. So ladies and gentlemen, I urge you today, do not get caught up in the spirit of fear. Because as you sit in this church today, you know as well as I know that that is not the spirit instilled in you. Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 11 says, continue to encourage one another and lift each other up. That is the only difference that I need to make in this world on a daily basis. My brothers and my sisters, on a daily basis, you have to encourage one another and lift each other up. So as I set forth to find a dynamic man and some dynamic gentleman speakers and men in business and men in networking, and I am determined to prove to the society that all men are not, all black men are not bad people. I have to change the face of America. And because I am a very faithful and spiritual person, nothing is impossible to me. So I am determined to show that black men in America work, that black men in America have families, that black men in America go to college. Not everyone, obviously, but there wouldn't be full historically black colleges if we didn't go to college. We do. We own homes. We've got jobs. We've even got retirement plans. The level of education does not stop. If you want the education, plenty of us know it's out there. We've taken advantage of it. So believe you all that we have to change the face of black America and believe and trust in your own community. And those of you who are here to serve and protect our community, believe the best in your brothers and sisters, because we are brothers and sisters in humanity. So believe the best, number one. Let's start to erode those negative stereotypes, one person at a time. So, as my men's meeting came to pass, it's coming, and Mr. Kevin Doraville answered my invitation graciously to come and be a speaker at my very first men's meeting. Mr. Kevin Doraville is a youth mentor, an author, and a writer. He has an interesting story to tell about his life, from escaping the streets, jail, and death. He eventually worked his way into corporate America as a top marketing director for a multi-million dollar construction firm. In realizing his passion to push others forward, eventually he began writing a memoir that transformed into a powerful, inspirational autobiography, a stage play, and a documentary. The Courage to Believe, he called it, Never Give Up. All of which are available on his website. And you all know it's going to be www.kevindoraville.com. Okay, that's easy. So if you want to continue to find out and follow him, go to that website. He is coming now with his kind of controversial book. It's called The Seven Types of Queens That Kings Desire. This is coming up in September of this year. He graduated with a bachelor's degree in political science and a minor in marketing from the Florida Atlantic University in 2005. He is a member of the Martin Luther King Celebration Committee of Fort Lauderdale, New Gay Movement Mentoring Program Group, and the Haitian American Leadership Organization. He spent 2 years as a Sunday school teacher at his home church, Redeeming Word Christian Ministries. He now is a born-again African spiritualist. Mr. Doraville has been on the Trinity Broadcasting Network, Hot 105, 99 Jams. He's been on magazine covers. He's been in the newspapers, the Florida Courier, the Pelican Post. He's been a part of the African History Network. He's been in the West Side Gazette. Needless to say, ladies and gentlemen, I can go on and on, but this gentleman, he is getting the recognition in which he deserves because he is tireless. He is tireless in defending the fact that how can we ask for security and protection and profit and existence if we don't continue to work in love. He is a victim of violent crime. Despite countless oppositions, Mr. Drover kept his faith in God, knowing that there will always be opposition to purpose, and he kept moving forward, encouraging teens and young adults on how to pursue their dreams. He puts a fire in the spirit of all he comes in contact with. What he does to these youth on a daily and weekly basis cannot be explained in words, ladies and gentlemen. You just have to get next to him and feel the fire. You have to get next to Kevin Dorable to understand what he is about. I've seen this man work the last 3 years, tireless, I tell you, to change the minds of young America. Ladies and gentlemen, please get on your feet right now and thank this man for owning the responsibility as a black man in America that he sees the problem and he will not rest until he is part of the solution. Ladies and gentlemen, put your hands together, Mr. Kevin Dorable.
Reached out to me through social media and asked me, did I need any help? So I hired her to be my assistant. She's been a huge help. Way in Philadelphia. I haven't never even met the young lady. But I know she's watching. Bless you. The Haitian Evangelical Baptist Church, Pastor Deli Noir, who's my childhood pastor. And when I do get married, he's going to marry me. So you might have like a bidding war between him and Pastor Dozier, my pastor at Redeemer Word Christian Center, Pastor Ed, and Pastor Deli Noir. All right, Sugar Memories, she donated some cupcakes and candies and sweets, which we will be giving away in the raffle drawing. Classic Trends here on Hammerville, Ashley Mohorn, and all the other beautiful sisters that do the hairdos. We'll be doing a few raffle drawings. So if you did not get a raffle ticket, there's someone passing them out. We're selling them $2 a ticket. And we are going to do something with the money. There's a woman that I hope she comes today. I want to give her all the money that we get to give to her. So please purchase a raffle ticket. So Sophia, she's walking around somewhere. I'm sure she's going to help one of the volunteers to make sure that she goes and do that. All right, here she goes. All right, and Hood Diesel. Thank you, Hood Diesel Barbershop. Next Level Barbershop. Both of these men are black business owners, and they donated free haircuts. So part of raffle drawing, you can get a free haircut as well. Dale's Tires. Thank you, Linda, for your support. I always knew that Dale's going to support me eventually. They put the big rims on cars off Sunrise. Forgive me, I have a lot of thank yous. You know, I always forget to say thank you to somebody, but this time I made sure I put it, just like our ancestors in the pyramids put the evidence on the walls, I put it on paper, all right? So, Heart City Library, we're gonna do a special thank you to Mrs. Deborah Floyd, so just sit tight, don't go anywhere. She is responsible for allowing Courage to Lead International for having our chess program, and also New Game Movement. We have Bo and Mr. Jihad. Please stand up, New Game Movement. Thank you. We have about 20 of us strong that are doing things in the community. I joined these fellas because of the strong things they're doing for young black men in the community. As a matter of fact, Monday we just finished an etiquette program where we taught the young men how to tie ties. You know, and that was so cool. As a matter of fact, I think that we really need to support New Game Movement and all the other nonprofit organizations that are actually trying to do something in the community. We cannot afford to allow these nonprofit organizations to close their doors or never have sufficient amount of funds to continue running. Because all we gotta do is catch the kids. See all these beautiful young kids right here? Please stand up. Many of them are volunteers from Eastern Stars. They are the future. So every single one of us need to be providing an environment so they can learn and develop. Not in the jail system, not in juvenile halls and jails and prisons, but in the schools, in the churches, in the community. We have to do whatever we have to do to protect them because they are the future. And they are the core reason why I am doing what we are doing today with Courage Speak International. Amen. Thank you. Motivational Movement Network, Mrs. Connie Moss. Thank you so much. She was on the panel last year. She did donate to our fundraiser today. Thank you for her. Who was it I forget? We have New Game Movement, I mentioned. One Way Young Charity, David Miller, God bless you. Dollar General donated $50. And this guy is not a black guy, it's a white guy. Donated $50 with no hesitation. Yes, I want to support. So thank you to Dollar General. Right there up on Power 9. The Pelican Post newspapers for being the first ones to write an article about this event and organization. American Free Press, I don't know if Gary's here, who interviewed me the other day. Westside Gazette did an awesome paper. Office Depot on 441 in Oakland. These people stayed up with me until about 11 o'clock at night, 1 hour past the closing time, to actually let us give out the programs, get them printed, and make them look nice. So I don't know if all you all got a program, but please, I know Brother Fuller or the volunteers, make sure they get the program. Gary's outside somewhere. So find him, make sure every single one of these individuals, because we worked hard last night to get these programs. I want everybody to get a program, please. Florida Courier, thank you for their support. They've been supporting me since 2008 when I first started my clothing line, One Man Army and One Woman Army. And who reads Florida Courier here? Florida Courier readers? You know the part in the end when they talk about Florida's finest? I was on it about 2-3 times. But this time, I'm not way in the back, I'm going to be in the front because they asked me to speak on behalf of the black community as one of the leaders on the front lines on the war for our young black men. So give it up for Florida Carrier, Hot 105. Thank you. Hot 105, Raleigh, Baltimore, been supporting us since day one, since the Courage to Believe stage play, the book signing, which you do have for sale in the back in the corner of the cafeteria. Michael Imhotep of African History Network. These people have like a million followers on Facebook and on their internet show. A million followers. And he asked me to be on the show, and he had his followers donated right there while I was on the air. They donated about $150. So God bless them. They're up there in Detroit. And I do plan on doing some work in Detroit. Not me, but us. Because without no us, there's no me. Unity is, you know what I'm saying, is the key. Power and unity. Which you see on the front of the shirt that these volunteers are wearing. And we're going to get a chance to see them. They're going to be some of the bios, which will be pretty awesome. Broward County Cultural Arts Division. God bless you for all your support. Actually, the trailer we're going to play on the screen here a little bit, they actually, I won a grant to actually produce the documentary. It's called The Courage to Believe, Never Give Up. It's going to be very powerful. Trust me, we've worked on this for 2 years. Finally, everything that we've been dreaming about, praying about, everything God has blessed me with, my spirit has come into pass. Everything is manifesting as we speak. I wouldn't be here today looking as sharp as I am if it wasn't for God's ability to push me when I wanted to give up. And all the mentors in my life. The city of Pompano, thank you, Commissioner Phillips, and the mayor, Mayor Fisher, for supporting us. Actually, they sponsored the food for this event. So we want to give a big ups to them for their support. Mr. Phillips is in the back. Amen. And also, Mr. Harold Fine Fashions. I don't know if he made it today. See this nice suit I got on?
Alright.
You like that? Support this brother. Look, matter of fact, don't even support his business. Do not support Mr. Harold's Fine Fashion business. I want you to go there and shop at his business. Because when we go to the mall, we don't support the mall. We shop at the mall. Go ahead and store and support his business. It's on University and Open Area. You can call, text me, or go to the program and I'll send information. He has all kinds of deals and discounts. His brother has blessed me this year with this fine suit and also last year. And I'd like to give a special thanks to the whole Courage to Believe team. We're a very small team. However, we are efficient. And I'd like to give special thanks to Roslyn Aurelis. I know she's probably running around somewhere, but she was a big help. Gary Pierre, is Gary in here? Mr. Gary, way better. This guy here is a genius. He built our website, which I'm sure Mr. Bryan's up on the screen. Built the website, he does graphic designing, web designing. Contact him, I'm sure he has business cards, so hit me up and I'll make sure you get his information. He's also my cousin, so he really doesn't have a choice but to help. But I always tell him that, but I'm joking. Samson Pierre, God bless you, and congrats on your newborn son. Eric Carter, Kathleen Faye, I have to mention. Now before I talk about her, also Brother Leon right here. But Kathleen Faye is a mentor, devoted friend, and member of the Courage to Believe International. And unfortunately, she actually died a couple of months ago, giving birth to a newborn baby. And so she was always giving. She left this world giving birth to a child, a baby just survived. So please give her a round of applause. I know she's watching. Long time friend. As a matter of fact, before she passed away, and she didn't know she was going to pass away. I didn't know. She was trying to call me while I was at a workshop for the LEFT grant that BSO has for nonprofit organizations. And by the way, we are recipients of that grant for our CHESS program for the kids. So big ups to BSO. Thank you. And also, I would like to say that today is a very special day. I hope we have fun today. There's going to be a lot of entertainment. There's going to be questions to be asked, a lot of answers to be given. And just thank you, bless you, and God bless.
Ladies and gentlemen, let's hear from Mr. Gavin Durwall. Courage to Believe International. You can pass me that mic, please. We're going to continue with our program. Many of you have the programs now as they're being passed out. Again, my name is Suzette Speaks. It's an honor to be here as your mistress of ceremonies. We're going to continue with our special presentations before we get to our panel. Thank you, sir. You can just stay on there. Thank you, thank you. And we're going to invite up at this time for our first special presentation, Miss Deborah Floyd from Collier City librarian. She's a Collier. Let's welcome Miss Deborah up here. Collier City Librarian. How are you? And you got company there.
When Kevin's secretary called, she invited me to come, and she wouldn't tell me why I was being invited. She just said, you must be here. And I'm like, oh, I have visitors from out of town. I may not be able to get there. Oh, please, Deborah, please come. So I'm here, and I had no idea I was getting a special presentation on behalf of our library, but I am so delighted to be honored in such a fashion. The Collier City Library has been open in this community since 1985. Yet in many ways, I feel like it's the best kept secret in town, and we don't want to be a secret. So when Kevin, New Game Movement, and other organizations came to us asking us for space to meet in our facility, I was only too happy to do it. I'd rather see us open, full of activity, full of community organizations using us than to sit there with the room empty and no one is there. In 2003, we reopened again as the Jan Moran Collier City Learning Library. We met Mrs. Moran, and those of you in South Florida, I'm sure you know about them and they're huge philanthropists and donations in the community. They give to everywhere. But we had invited Maya Angelou, when she was alive, to come and speak. We had about 10,000 people outside. And after the program was over, we invited Maya inside the library. Mrs. Moran was one of those people who came inside. And our library has already, always been devoted to literacy. We teach adults who don't know how to read, we teach them to read. We teach children who do not know how to read, we teach them to read. And that is our mission, and it has been since we opened. And we won't change that. And so, Mrs. Moran listened to the adults in our program who had learned to read, and they were talking about the difference learning to read had made in their life. Improvement in all ways, and not just for the person who learned, but for their whole family. Because reading is power. Reading is something that once you learn how to do, no one can take that away from you. Reading is knowledge. And so we know how critical it is to someone's life. And I've been there at the library for 25 years now. And I started as a youth service program. And I've seen the children that were in my program grow up, and they're bringing their children to the library. And this gives me joy and pleasure because I see a cycle being created here. A little family of readers is developing. And so I just want to thank Kevin for this honor I didn't know I was getting today. And I want you to just see everybody in this room. I want to see you in the library. Okay, come and visit us. And I would like to also let you know I'm glad it's happening now because August 12th, I will be retiring. And that will be my last time with the library, except I'm coming as a volunteer.
She won't give it up. I love it.
I will be back to work and help in the community.
Ladies and gentlemen, let's acknowledge Ms. Deborah Floyd, Collier City Librarian.
Library group, that's how we get our donations.
We need to support queens like her, all right? So thank you.
Thank you. Next on our program, we are going to have a dance. We'd like to welcome up at this time, Miss Noesha Noel, for a special presentation.
So, say, social media, say, we used to meet local rifle shop. We did that. Just threw some ideas out. We didn't know what we wanted to do. Everyone's emotional, angry, hurt. But we decided we tried to set the job for several meetings. It's trying to get a sense of knowledge. And we decided to let your young boys go. You know, change their lives.
Very good. Thank you so much. Thank you very much. We got flyers.
picture together. And we definitely like to encourage people who want to be the change. Not talk about the change, but that are the change. You want, I thought it was a man thing, okay. Here for the new gay movement one more time. I'm gonna keep the show moving. Is there anybody who's celebrating a birthday today? Anybody's birthday today? You're kidding me. For real? What's your name? Come up. We have a small gift we would like to give you. It's actually a big gift. King Kevin Dorval's The Courage to Believe stage play. He wants to give it to you. What's your name? Tell us, what's your name and where you're from?
I'm here.
So may he rest.
rescue me, or let the enemy steal what God has promised me, or the cares of this world. See, I've been lost in my own mind for a long time. Dear Lord, I need your help to leave my past behind. Living life in the streets became a call to me. And I burst on my soul, God, faith with me. See, I've been lost in my own mind for a long time. Dear Lord, I need your help to leave my past behind. Living life in the streets became a call to me. And I burst on my soul, God, faith with me. So many years I said, tears my life still. Took a turn on the wrong road, my heart's cold. No understanding and never no love in the streets. That ain't a God, so that's the worst of the enemy. Who are we seeking? Christ needs the devil, man. Let's be specific. We ain't got no time for plan. This war is real. War for your soul. God's cold. I'm getting chills thinking about what's going on. So often, man, we fall victim our own way. We can't blame the devil. We help him out today. Those are the CEO assists in the way of the enemy. Fast money, fast car, man, that brother is. Who are we thinking? Broke your home around the way. You down the side, we still ain't got too much to say. Don't justify by the knowledge of the trust they make you choose. Let's try to tap into what God expects for us to do. Thank y'all for having me. Thank y'all.
Stephen Gaskins to the stage to present a spoken word piece. Do we have any more programs? We want to make sure we get some programs on this side of the room. A couple people have asked us for programs. And we're going to also acknowledge people who are running for office in just a moment as we get set to start our panel. All right, welcome. Let's hear it from Mr. Stephen Gaskins.
How y'all doing? How y'all doing? I'm honored to be here in support of my brother Kevin and what's going on. We're living in some really crazy times, and it's inspiring to see brothers that have come from the other side, like New Game Movement, and are, you know, helping our communities, and like the young man, brother that just left, that's, you know, living testimonies that, you know, we was in the streets, we was doing things, and now we're here in the communities trying to help, trying to give back. I have like the same testimony where I was in the streets trying to do my thing. And, you know, right here in the city of Pompano, though I'm from Fort Lauderdale, it's many times I've been shot at here and almost lost my life here in the city. And I'm blessed to be here to be able to give back. And so my heart, like a lot of these gentlemen, goes out to our black communities, our black families, and for me, especially our black men, because we're the staple of the family. Like, we hold the weight of the family. If we can get the father, the leader, the male out of the family, then there's no protection, really, over the family. So this piece I'm about to do speaks to men, especially our young black girl.
I am the quietest volcano. I am the softest lava. I am a wonder to behold, a destruction to be touched. I cannot be contained, I am controlled. My power is humbled, I am humbly proud. I am the cool breeze of Hurricane Steve. I am the quenching rain of a perfect storm. I am a tornado at sea, peacefully treading waters. My power is humbled, I am humbly proud. And with great power comes great responsibility. And my response is my ability to illustrate strength under control. I have learned meekness. I am the antonym to weakness. I am a runner onto a sentence that dare defy me. I'm a fist to chest up to any opposition that dare defies me. I am humbly proud. Stronger than stone. I was pressured into being a precious stone. I shine bright like a diamond. With skin as tough as diamonds, I am a beauty to behold. With the awe of a God that never falters, I am humbly proud. Royalty from the royalist bloodline. I am a born bred king to be, a strong prince given room to reign. I am heir to greatness. I am the seed of a legend, the legacy of a god, the offspring of a ruler. hate roars with thunder. The battle cries of legions of warriors. My veins are dry ice, fighting to contain the heat of my soul. I have danced in the rain of my tears by crossing oceans of my emotions. I am the helm, watch my control. I am humble and proud. And because of that, I choose to be responsible. I choose to one day show my son that though his fist can close a mouth, that his mouth can open a hand, that being a man is just as much about being gentle as it is about being strong. And I choose to one day show my daughter that though she is well capable and strong enough to open her own door, that she is powerful enough to be meek, to allow him, that she is a gem, beautiful far before she was ever told, and that her worth is far beyond rubies and gold. And I choose to use my time to educate them that love is, was, and will always be in my rib. I will love her like it's no one's business. Because a woman cultivated becomes a force motivated. So I choose to build her up with attention to detail so that her love can rest on the assurance of the foundations on my shoulders. Rest easy. I am shelter. There is shelter in my arms because I know who I am. Hail a king, son of the king, and to whom all was created, predestined. A provider of hope, a light, beginning faith for my family by following my provider. I am an avid learner, ever evolving from what I used to be to more of what they need me to be. I am a front runner, a frontline soldier. I used to be a zero until I was touched by the supernatural, which mighty more by natural into a superhero. Should I have all the Avengers? I am the first line of defense for this family. I am who they're going to call, and I will not be Ghostbuster. I am here. I am watching, but do not awaken me.
Spoke to me. We became good friends, and
It's ironic that I'm here today at this spot on Black on Black Crime Solution. My brother was killed by a police officer, Norman Roger, back in October of last year, Corey Jones. And it's real hard to really talk about it. I just want to be here and offer all my services to this little hill. I'm not a part of anything in the community or anybody's community. I deal with kids. I'm a mentor. And I want to be a part of something. And I love this movie, what you got going on. And I'm giving this opportunity and I'm offering my services to you. Whatever I can do for the other the new game, whatever it is, I'm here to help. I played in the NFL for 7 seasons. I have a Super Bowl perfect season ring. It's a lot of hard work. The message to the kids, I mean, it can be done. I went to junior college, transferred to Iowa, graduated from the University of Iowa, and I continued on to graduate in African American World Studies in sports management. I also have a restaurant, a vegan restaurant, and I'm sports training. So all of this saying is, it can be done. I didn't know nothing about all this stuff you've done, bro. Are you serious? I haven't talked to this guy since 99. That's when I graduated. And I jumped on this as soon as one of my other homeboys had called me and he was like, "You should come out." And I talked to him and he was like, "You don't know if I was going to come." And he was scared to ask me. I was like, "Man, I'm normal. You can pinch me. Just speak me, I'm okay."
Super Bowl winner, but still normal.
Yeah, I'm normal. I'm out. I'm always trying to help. I'm here, man. I'm grateful and thank you for this opportunity to be here, and thank you for everything.
Thank you. Let's hear it. Thank you. He will be on our panel in just a little bit. And at this time, because he has to leave, I'm going to ask Sheriff Israel, is he available? Because I know he has to leave for a press conference. You guys know, is the person who broke out of the jail still on the run? Did they catch him? Not yet. All right, so he has a lot on his mind right now as we try to make sure we apprehend that person. And we wanted, before you had to leave, sir, to give you an opportunity to say a few words. Please welcome our current Broward County Sheriff.
Around the nation, don't do it right every day.
we make mistakes. There's a reason we make mistakes. We come from the human race and we're not him. And there's not one industry on earth where everybody does it right. Every week, I walk through the halls, Reverend, of the Brown Sheriff's Office, and I see somebody there and you go, wow, how did he or she get to where they are? But there can't be one person out there that in your business or where you work or where you go and travel that you don't see one person where you say, wow, how did this happen? About a week ago, 7 men were buried, 5 in Dallas, 1 in Minnesota, and 1 in Louisiana, that all should have been going to barbecues with their family on that Sunday. I'm going to make a strong statement at this stage from what I'm seeing. I don't know that community and police, and we got it right in Broward County. We do it better here than so many places around because of you folks. You respect us, we respect you, we do it better than so many people. But at this point in America, after that tragic week, I'm going to tell you this, and I'm telling you, Sister Sheriff, we need God to be involved in this more than ever and ever before. It's not going to happen. I see a day, I really do. I see a day, I talk to my deputies about this all the time, where our deputies step out of the vehicle and they go to help a citizen. Maybe they have to arrest the citizen. Maybe they have to do a traffic ticket to the citizen. But I pray for that day where whatever they see, all they see is an American citizen. They do not see color, they do not see sex, they do not see anything else but the person they're there to deal with. Conversely, I see a day, I pray for a day, where the community doesn't see a black officer stepping out of the vehicle, or a Hispanic officer, or a white officer. They see a police officer stepping out who's there to do his or her job. We're the people, you know, church, we're the same people you sit in next to church. You see us in Publix. You see us on the football field. We fumble and throw interceptions like you do. We score touchdowns and hit home runs like you do. We're part of this community. That's all we are, is we're part of this community. As your sheriff, I'm admitting, we don't do it right all the time. And when we don't do it right, let Reverend know. Let Internal Affairs know. Let me know. Call a lawyer. Call your parents. But as I conclude, I'm compelled to tell this story. Colonel Pollock and I were at Piper High School several months ago, and it was a program for the kids. 2 moms came up to us, African-American, each one. One had no idea, the other spoke to us, and they were asking questions. And we were taking selfies and pictures, and these were all positive, upbeat questions. Until the moms said independently to each other, I'm the mother of a 16-year-old son, one was 17. When my sons go out at night, I'm scared. I'm scared for their safety. You with me, Mom? So it changed my whole day around. I went from a happy-go-lucky day to a very solemn, very, very serene sheriff. And here's what I would say, or what I said to those moms, and I grabbed the mic back from the principal, and here's what I said to the students. They weren't happy because they had to stand there for 10 minutes and listen to me. But here's what I said to the church. Please coach, counsel, and mentor your children. And remember this, with all due respect to the pastors and the clergy and the sheriffs and the football coaches and the teachers, make no mistake about it. The one most important person in the child's life is the parents. You need to take care of your kids. You need to be in charge of your homes. And if you need to spank your kid or discipline your kid, you spank your kid and you discipline your kid. But But I'll say this, in church, I'll leave you with this. Please coach, counsel, and mentor, and tell your kids this. If they have an encounter on the street with a police officer or with a deputy, and they say they're doing everything right, yes, sir, no, ma'am, they're respectful and they're polite, and the officer's not, and the officer's going in a direction where he or she has no right to go, disrespectful, rude, whatever else, something that would embarrass me as a sheriff, to know that one of our deputies did that, please, please tell your children to not fight that battle on the street. Violence, as Dr. King said, violence begets nothing but violence. Not going to let that officer win on the street. And as soon as it's over, write it down. Document it. Make that complaint. Don't let that go.
So what you're saying is let this person, this individual, get harassed and beat up if it comes necessary. If some of y'all be like that, I'm in these streets. That's what you're saying, right?
Well, I would not want to see anybody get beat up or harassed.
You said just write it down on paper. Right? Let me go ahead and address the people. To write it down on paper, if one of these people, your officers, come out here that are corrected, okay, and stand with a code of silence to back up each other, if they beat down this nigga here in these streets, because that's what he is, you know what I'm saying? Don't say what? Let's face facts. Let's keep it G. You know what I'm saying? You're going to keep it real. You're going to keep it respectful. You know what I'm saying? But how you going to expect this person out here that just got beat up by this police officer to be like, yeah, just write it down and come see about you? When you took an oath and a code of silence to back up him and him and him and him and him and all the other motherfuckers out there.
Right, not every day. People in the community make mistakes, they break the law, they outward behavior of a small amount of individuals. 99% of our community does things right every day. And I ask you, don't judge us on the outward behavior of a small amount of police officers.
Thank you, Jeremy. We're going to start, first of all, I want people to be able to get in contact with you. I know you've got to leave, but how do people get in contact with you? Because you can't stay for the discussion. You have a press conference that you have to go to about this gentleman who has escaped. Please let us know where we can email you, where we can find you.
If you could get a hold of us at www.sheriff.org, you can go on Ask the Sheriff, or you can call 954-321-4605.
Repeat that, so write it down and I'll repeat it again.
954-321-4605. Kevin, thank you for hosting this tonight. Kevin, thank you for inviting
me. Thank you.
God bless you all.
Let's also get our note cards for questions circulating so that we'll take a quick picture with the sheriff. We want to make sure we get questions because obviously you have a lot to ask.
I'm just trying to live my life. Every day I'm trying to live a life, I'm trying to live a bright life. I'm just trying, I'm trying to get by. Every day I'm trying to get by, that's why I get by.
Hey, you might just dedicate it right here, you know. All the people, you know.
Appreciate it. At this time, you want to do a quick picture? You want to do a quick picture? True Tony in the building. All these great, talented rappers we have. Wonderful. Let's hear it one more time for True Tony. And at this time, we would like to hear from the Worldwide Christian Center Youth Choir. It's about time. Yes, come on up. So excited to have you.
Come on, put your hands together again for the Youth Choir. Youth Choir is coming to tell you today that yes, you can. If you just try. If you believe you can do it, you can achieve it. But you have to have courage. Come on, put your hands together. Listen, gather around. Listen well, I'm here to tell you what you do. Oh, simple songs, simple melodies to remind you that you can be a great endeavor, be clever. Even though sometimes you may lose, come on, y'all.
Trials.
You can do anything.
good job. Very good job. And at this time, we're going to have a quick documentary on Courage to Believe International. Pardon? Trailer. Uh-oh. Come tell us real quick what it is. Come tell me. And then we will introduce our panelists.
Glad you asked. We're getting ready to pay the documentary trailer. It's only like 2 minutes. It's not that long. They will go right into the panel discussion. But the choir, I have a gift for each and every one of you.
Oh, wow.
I want to give all of you a free DVD copy of our stage play that we did. So be sure to check with me in the back when this is over, okay?
Yay.
Amen. God bless you. That's an awesome job. Give a round of applause.
Yay.
Are you ready? All right, let's run it.
Checking out, this is my whole neighborhood here in Cypress, the father of Seaview County. I'm Key Kettlemore. This is where it all began, you know, the humble beginnings.
But the key for our people is we have to learn how to survive. We have to learn how to be a voice, but we can't do it in anger.
You trust God no matter what. And David said, this is how we wait for the Lord to be able to turn and say, again, I say, wait for the Lord.
Back then, I felt like I could do it. I just did it because I felt like, hey, I could do it. Not bad. Knocked out again. Yeah. Never for me. Refuse. Lose. Refuse. And now.
Demetriana King, yes, she's back in the house. Miss Tanasia Akins. All right, Miss, you ready? Who are you going to introduce first? Nice and loud.
Inventor, or as most recognize her, me, is very reputable, enthusiastic, self-motivated, driven, and extremely inspiring community, a body kit and organizer, who has also officially been branded as the Big Mouth of Liberty City. A Miami native, Valencia has hosted and organized many different initiatives and events in Liberty City, including the annual I, a Woman, Women's Expo, founder of Make the Homelessness Smile, Miami and Atlanta. Valencia also helps with assisting many community-based organizations as a variety of events around South Florida and partners with many grassroots to assure that there is real change being executed. For example, she is a proud board member of Liberty City's Belfonte Tocolsi Center. Through the relationships, they host their annual Hood Week, which gives grassroots and grass top organizers a chance to feel the heartbeat of the community. Also, an ecopreneur at EcoTech Visions, which is a green business incubator in Liberty City, she assists EcoTech Visions with community engagement, with helping inform the community of opportunities of green jobs and free coding classes that are offered in her community. Valencia, who is not an environmentalist, has partnered with the CLIO institution with leading the conversation around climate awareness in Liberty City, in which they had a community forum that allowed residents and local political figures to have a discussion on corners around sea level rise, emergency preparedness, and climate gentrification. Also spoke at the 2016 May Day March in front of an audience of 300 people about climate change. Valencia has been fighting alongside the residents of her community to reassure they receive fair treatment and make sure that they are not forgotten about. Please welcome Ms. Valencia Lerner.
Prosecutor of the Year by Broward County Crime Commission.
2016, on behalf of the Sex Crimes and Child Abuse Unit, she received the Prosecutor Unit of the Year Award from the Broward County Department. In 2015, she also received a Superior Public Service Certificate of Award from the Broward County Crime Commission. She was a panelist for the Child on Child Sexual Abuse Symposium and serves as a mentor to new attorneys. She resides in the plantation with her family. Please welcome Ms. Neva Rainford Smith.
Missionary Baptist Church, where Reverend Robert C. Stanley is senior pastor.
Additional affiliations include, and he's a member of the Ada Nu chapter of Omega Psi Phi Fraternity Incorporated, Pompano Beach, Florida, Police Benevolent Association, Freemasonry, Pompano Beach Kiwanis, and MLK Planning Committee, among others. Citations, proclamations, and reflections were heartfelt and varied, coming from dignitaries such as former Pompano Beach Commissioner Boudreaux Cordier, Pompano Beach Mayor Lamar Smith, Pastor Robert Stanley, Virginia Jones from the Coral Springs Police Department. You got so many endorsements, I can't read them all. We would like to salute him. Let's thank and welcome Mr. Willie Jones to our family. Here? Okay, we'll skip him and come back if he comes, please. You have one more? Go ahead.
I would like to introduce Dr. A.K. Tosu. Dr. A.K. Tosu is a social, structural analyst and international educator whose work centers on facilitating resolution processes pertaining to human relations, culture and diversity, leadership, and education. He has a BA in managerial economics and MA in cross-disciplinary studies with focus on culture and diversity in a physical D and conflict analysis and resolution. Please welcome now Dr. A.
AK, good to have you. Come, beautiful. Running for office, Ms. Bartleman, is it?
Yes.
School board?
Yes.
All right, Ms. Bartleman, wait. Anybody else who's running for office who's here, please? Ed Phillips, what's up? How are you, sir? Good to see you. Anybody else? I know there was a judge or two. They left? Okay. I just want to make sure we recognize people who take time out of their schedules to come be a part of a community event such as this one. So as we get the cars circulating, let me start with the Supervisor of Elections Office, Mr. Herring. Nearly 6 million citizens cannot vote, and the way this question puts it is due to felony disenfranchisement, which really affects many people of African descent in our country. What can we be doing, or what can your office be doing, to see to it that this pattern may be reversed? Next to Dr. AK, there's one mic right next to you. Go ahead. I think all of them are on. Just make sure.
Okay.
There you go.
Good afternoon. Yes, it's an excellent question, as a matter of fact. We we have voter registration drives all over the county, as you probably well know. But most importantly is that laws that are in place in the state of Florida. Folks need to understand that these laws in the state of Florida are only for the citizens of Florida. There are other states in the country that also have laws that prohibit felons from registering to vote. The most important thing to understand is we all need to work towards changing those laws. And that's the most important thing that's the loudest question I can probably say today is that
does Dr. Snipes have a stance on that?
Being that we are a government office, we cannot have a partisan voice. Although we can make sure everyone understands how the laws are made and how the laws can be changed. Other states in the country, as well as Florida, one of the few states left to make it hard for felons to get registered to vote.
Who would change that? Is that something that comes from the state legislature?
Absolutely.
Okay, so the state legislature would have to pass a law that would allow people with felonies on their record to go through a process to be reinstated with the ability to vote. Is that what needs to happen?
Absolutely. And just like any other law that changes in the state of Florida, that's the same thing. Traditionally, you can go ahead and get petitions signed.
Okay.
You can call
it. It can be a ballot initiative if we have enough petitions signed.
Absolutely. Okay. That's how it works.
Attorney Banks, you wanted to add?
I do. Felony disenfranchisement with voting is very popular here in Florida. And it takes place with our governor, who passed an executive order to make it so that felons would be able to vote after their convictions. So we really need to pay attention to who we elect in our local offices. I think it's only important to mention that this is election season. So really pay attention. It's important that felons vote.
Sheriff Kennedy Jones, do you have an opinion on this?
I will chime in and say the same thing. For many years, we've been electing people that have name recognition or a lot of money, but don't have our interest at heart. We need to become better stewards of the vote that we're given. I say to all the adults in here, we have possibly failed our children. And the reason I say that is because not any of our children has ever voted for the people that's governing them right now. We need to get the millennials, the young people, you need to vote. Because not only would this president have an option of selecting 3 to 4 Supreme Court judges, there's about 78 federal appellate judges, courtships there. And the thing about that is, they are all appointed for life. These people that they put in place now will be governing setting laws for the next 40 to 50 years. So it is important to get everybody engaged. Now I know the millennials say my vote don't count. The only vote that does not count is the one that's not cast.
I want to talk a little bit about the decriminalization of marijuana. As many of us who voted in the last election know, there was a ballot measure that was there for all of us to read and see. I think for Florida, it takes 60% of the popular vote to pass and add it to our Constitution. Can you believe that's the easiest way to change the Florida Constitution? 60% of the populace of that election. So it lost by about 3%. And we know a lot of our young men end up in trouble for carrying small, very small amounts of marijuana. The usage rates among different communities are the same. However, the criminalization tends to happen, I guess, in certain areas more than others. Who would like to comment on the decriminalization movement and what impact it will have on young people as far as getting a criminal record?
Willie Jones, I think that we need to support that for personal use only, because many of our kids, they get the misdemeanor charge, and then when they go to the Army, try to get in college, it's on their record. We need to make sure we can ensure their future is not hindered by a childhood decision. Now here in Broward County, the county commissioner has passed a civil citation for adults using marijuana. The current administration has failed to put it into play. They are still physically arresting young people for the possession of marijuana when they just issued a civil citation. For that, it will be simply a fine.
How many people have an opinion on, I'm just gonna take a random poll, how many people would like to see for small amounts of marijuana decriminalization? How many people oppose it? I'm just curious.
If I could say one thing.
Please.
We just took a vote on the decriminalization of marijuana. But what I want to stress is that when we have an election of August 30th, about a third of this room, and that's giving it a lot of credit, will show up for that election. And we've got to change that specifically. That equals about four or five of these pews for the rest of the whole church making a decision for everybody else. And if we want something to change, now speaking outside of my turn here, but if we want something to change, we have got to step up and know that our voices do count. We've got to vote on the local elections. Presidential election, that's in November. The next most important election is always the next one, and that is August 30th. Your folks that are locally are on that ballot. Those are the folks that matter to us in Broward County, from Hollandale to Deerfield Beach. Those are the ones that we have to make sure are our concern immediately.
Not skipping the primaries in March, not skipping the ones in August, because, oh, we only care about the president. I'm not talking about anybody here. I'm talking about everybody here. But your point is well taken. Yes, Minister.
I think just an issue as well. I think a little bit deeper as a people. A lot of times something appeared to be positive on the surface. But when we dig a little deeper, there's a more sinister move. At one time, alcohol was illegal. And we all know that alcohol was being used in the commission of crimes. One of the most heinous crimes alcohol was used in when a man gets drunk and takes down his wife and children. We got mothers against drunk drivers now, sad, students against drunk drivers, dads against drunk drivers. Alcoholism and driving drunk has put a lot of people in their graves. It's cost the country a lot of money through lawsuits and other things along those lines. There was an FBI agent that was driving on the wrong side of the street. They killed two young black men.
It was my classmates.
And I'm sad to say that at one time alcoholism was illegal. Now, the thing is, how can we find balance? Because we know a lot of our people, particularly young blacks and our young generation, are being incarcerated for the use of marijuana. But it's also a social drug, which means it gives them another excuse to lay around the house because, you know, you want to eat, you get what's called a munchies, they want to go to Burger King and hang around. We have enough of these.
They don't know about that.
Laying around doing nothing. And so, yeah, we want to make sure we watch the criminalization of it. But then there's other social that spill out long to the community long after the law has been passed. And then also we're talking about voter apathy, where, you know, when we cast the vote locally, it really has impact for the mayor, for police chief, or things on those lines for sheriff. But on a national level, as we vote, those votes, as you know, we're giving
That's not the point of it, nigga. I want to talk about voter apathy, where it means that if you always in state, that we don't really go out and vote. We don't pay attention to what's going on politically, what politically enough. And what impact would the use of marijuana have on continuing that impact? We've got an easy goal, you know, our lucky individual who vicariously lives his life does not get involved in anything. You know, you go to Jamaica and the term is easy money. Easy money, you know, on vacation, everybody's kind of laid back. You go to the resort, to resorts and people take any time. And the reality is that the truth about it is that marijuana usage in Jamaica is passive. You're not being criminalized by it, but it really has an impact on your overall conduct, your overall behavior. And so I just think that we need to make sure we study that and look to see as telling the leaders and as a population what lingering or lasting effects impact it's going
to
have.
So where do you stand? Tell us. You said that to say what?
I said to say we'll go down a slippery slope than where you start. See, once you open Pandora's box, then you begin to get to a point where you have an entire generation, an entire society, while morals are affected by the leading example we have as far as being men and women, our character, values, all of those things are suffering when we get to the point where we start allowing things to happen. And I'm certain that one in this room can identify with what I'm saying. You know, if you tell your child something and you don't keep your word, you can yell and scream on your mom and your dad all you want. But every time you break your word with your child, you lose more and more credibility. And therefore, you won't be able to get them to do what you want them to do. So as we go down this slippery slope with alcohol, now it's marijuana, trust me, next thing is going to be cocaine.
So your point is
I'm not forward. I'm thinking we have your education.
Yeah.
And look at options.
Excellent. We want to switch to some of the educators on the panel. You want to add something?
Yeah, I just wanted to say that if you look at the whole overall gist of the agenda that's going on, when you start to realize that if you do approve of it for small amounts, what is that going to do? You still have, it still comes from the top. Because we can sit here and say you can have black police officers in black communities, but if the agenda from up top is always targeting minorities, then it's even worse because now you can't label a cop as being a racist. It's our own brother. Our own brother doing the same thing to us. So it's like if you open up that box and people say all over, okay, it's beneficial to us, but in the long run, you're still being targeted. So all you're doing is really decreasing the number a little because it's easier to get a conviction, it's easier to target a minority than it is to target somebody in the white community or who has money and get a conviction out of them. So you're preying on the small people, which is not gonna really make a big difference like that. It's like, where do we go from there? If you look at the marijuana dispensary, you can't even, as a black person, can't even open that up. You're not. You have to join in with somebody from another race, you know.
Point is well taken. I wanted to ask another question because this kind of lends to the school to prison pipeline. We've heard a lot about that, how young kids, do you know that there are officers that are arresting kids instead of sending them to the principal's office, instead of internal suspension, instead of home suspension? Do you know they're being arrested? Sent to, I don't think of it as a kiddie jail, it's like a jail. And I think it was our great Governor Jeb Bush who removed any type of military alternative courses for young men and women to go to hopefully kind of get back on the right track. So let's talk about the school to prison pipeline. Dr. AK, I know you're an educator. What can be done in the schools to lessen that pipeline? And what is actually happening that is encouraging that pipeline?
Well, we jump in. Greetings. That's Swahili for greetings. Now, I have to start off and say asante, thank you to Baba Kevin Kinke for putting this together. I believe it's the third year. It's a beautiful thing. So let's give him a round of applause. And also, asante to the bishop, is it pastor, for allowing us to be his home today. And a round of applause for him. If you don't mind standing up, so that people can know who you are. We have to realize, although we are in the same space, we do not share the same reality. Let me repeat that. Although we are in the same space, we do not share the same reality. We've spoken on decriminalization. We have spoken on the education. The first thing you have to understand is decriminalize the institution called the United States of America. Now we have silence. The second thing we have to understand is, what does education serve? Education, simply put, is a formal preparation. But the question is, preparation for what? There are 7.2 billion people estimated in this world, of which 4.6 billion are those of higher melanin count, that is those of darker brown skin complexion. In any situation in life, you have to understand authorship. There is always an author to any reality. And there are only three cultures in this world. Al-Kabulan, which has been misrepresented as Africa. Al-Kabulan means mother of mankind, land of the spirit people. There is Asia, and then there is Europe. You have to understand the authorship of what is today. So we talk about education, we talk about officials, we talk about even the gentleman who was in here, Scott Israel. We have to understand one thing called the state of mind. There is nowhere where the European has been in all their history and has not brought with them death, mayhem, and confusion to a people. Now we are quiet. What represents a people, you have to understand what represents history. The police department for a people who are of a higher melanin count, that is of a higher brown skin complexion, the police department represents the Gestapo. That is what the Jew, you will know today, how they related in Germany. The history of the police department has not been anything but hostile. And it's not the individuals today who are wearing uniforms. It's the history of the organization. So when you talk about addressing a situation or looking at a solution, you look at the entity, not the people just trying to pick up a paycheck. When we talk about education, the question is, what has education in a terroristic environment called the United States of America, what has it served from its inception? The education of the United States, being a criminally established institution, served to create subservient, passive, dependent individuals.
Yes, sir.
That's right. That is the history. So if you have a certain product today, you have to understand how the machine has been made. And then you begin to address the machine, not individuals.
Thank you, Dr. Akeka. Mr. President, you want to add to your question?
Absolutely. If I may, in reference to the question, what has been done to have an impact on the school to prison pipeline, I can tell you that the state attorney's office, Mike Sachs, the current sitting state attorney, is aware of the problem. I'm not a juvenile prosecutor, but I'm aware of what they're doing in the juvenile division, and they have developed the Promise Program, which is an attempt to put an end to that school-to-prison pipeline. The state attorney is working with the school board and the various agencies to alleviate that.
Just go ahead and just for people who may not know what it is that the school board partnered with your office, just describe what the Promise Program means.
As I said before, I am not one of the juvenile prosecutors,
that's fine.
But I do know that it's an attempt to give these kids who would be arrested in a first offense, they're given second and third chances to keep them out of the juvenile justice system, out of the prison system.
and give them a chance to get an education, to make something in their lives. Thank you.
You know, the reality is that we have a gentleman back here like to speak.
I wanted to explain the Promise Program.
Okay, we're going to keep on track.
I want to say something like educational, because I'm a Broward County high school teacher for the past 20 years.
30 seconds, go ahead, 30 seconds.
The reality is that the curriculum is not designed to hold the interest of our young men and women in schools. I have to work extra hard to bring other sources and things there so I can teach them. I have a discipline promise. I don't write the first. I don't have any discipline issues in my classroom because I am relating what is being taught to the experience of the students who are sitting before me. But I'm not certain if everybody has the ability to be able to do that. So anytime the system is not representing people, they can't find themselves on the pages of those books, then therefore they're going to find themselves in their mind on the outside of the institution. Therefore, our young men and women are acting up. They can't control themselves because they don't find any life in that classroom.
Thank you. Ms. Garman, really quickly, just to describe what the Promise Program is, and I want to move on to drugs in the community and the role that drugs are playing as far as crime goes.
I'm Robin Bartleman. I'm your countywide school board member. I want to tell you about the Promise Program because it is a national model on eliminating the schoolhouse to jailhouse pipeline. In 2011, Broward County Public Schools had the highest school-based arrest rate. That means we were taking children out of our classrooms and sending them to the jailhouse. In the room, led by Marsha Ellison, who's your president of the NAACP, the Advancement Project, Judge Elijah Williams, myself, Mike Sass, the State Attorney's Office, the Sheriff's Office, Howard Finkelstein, the Public Defender's Office, and the Juvenile Justice System, we all got together and we created a collaborative agreement. What that does is if a student commits 10 nonviolent misdemeanors, including marijuana, a minor misdemeanor amount, that child is not arrested. They are sent to the Promise Program, which is housed in one of our schools. There is a specialized curriculum. They meet with a school social worker and they meet with a psychologist. At that time, we address the needs of the whole child. They spend some